All right, moving on to the approval, oh, excuse me, we're going to start off with the roll call. How about that, Kathleen?
Commissioner Andrade?
Here.
Commissioner Brown?
Here.
Commissioner Hernandez?
Here.
Commissioner Quigley?
Here.
Chair Dickerson?
I'm here. All right, then we'll move on to the approval of the Planning Commission minutes of April 15th, 2015. Have all the commissioners had a chance to look them over, and are there any comments? If not, can I hear a motion?
I move that we approve the minutes from the consent calendar.
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. Public comment period.
Actually, wasn't it a motion to approve the minutes of April 15th? And not just the consent calendar?
No, it was just...
Because it was other business. Minutes.
Right, that's what we're doing. We did the minutes.
No.
Right.
Oh.
Yeah, no, she had said...
Approve the consent calendar.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, so I make a motion that we approve the minutes of the April 15th, 2015 meeting.
I'll second.
Thank you.
And all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? That motion carries. Public comment period. Each member of the audience may address the commission on any subject within the commission's business. Each member of the audience and each subject is limited to discussion of 3 minutes or as otherwise directed by the chair. These are for items not already on the agenda. Do we have anyone who wants to pontificate towards us, at us? Seeing none, we move on to the consent calendar. The consent calendar is approved with one motion. These items are read only on request of commission members. Should anyone, including members of the public, wish to discuss or disapprove any item, it must be dropped from the blanket motion and considered as a separate item. Do we have any commissioners who would like to see anything moved?
Yes, I would ask Chair Dickerson that you use the chair's prerogative to make two motions of two in the consent calendar. The reason being that I'm asking for that is that I, with regard to item number four, the Hayward Lumber Conditional Use Permit, I reside within 20 stones from there. So I would be recusing myself from voting on that item, but not with respect to the other items.
All right, so we will... bifurcate number four from the remaining groups. Are there any others?
Also, staff would like to pull item three off the consent calendar, and we've learned that the applicant, who's from out of town, is delayed in traffic, so their request is if it can be placed at the end of the regular meeting.
Okay. All right, so we will deal with the consent calendar for items number one and two only initially. Do we hear a motion to for those two items?
I move that we approve item one and two of the consent calendar.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Does Mr. Andrade have to step away?
Do we say anything about removing number three?
We did.
Yeah.
That's in there. Okay.
I will go ahead and start moving while you guys make your motion.
All right. Do we hear a motion for number three of the consent calendar? Number four, pardon me.
I make a motion to remove item four from the consent calendar.
No, to approve item
approve
four.
It. To approve item four.
There we go.
I'll second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Silence? And it moves, it carries. And we will bring Mr. Andrade back.
And he appears.
So the record should reflect that I have now returned to the dais with the rest of my fellow commissioners.
All right, so moving on to the public hearing, we are going to move on to number five, the Fairway Drive General Plan Land Use Map Amendment and Zone Change at On West Fairway Drive. Do we have a staff presentation?
Yes, this is a city-initiated amendment to the General Plan Land Use Map and Zoning Map. This came about due to staff's review and attempt to make our zoning map more accurate and legible. While doing so, we learned that this particular site has some unusual number of designations on our maps. This is an excerpt of our general plan land use policy map. The site itself has three different designations. Most of it is in our industrial land use. And there is a strip of open space that runs through the site. At one point, that was to be the location of a drainage channel, but it ended up being built on the southern property line. When that occurred, the land use map and zoning map should have changed, but it didn't. So this proposal would effectuate that change, make the whole site in the M1 industrial zone, and it would no longer have multiple zones, and it wouldn't have that open space segment going through the site. The two properties are owned, or there's two properties involved. One is owned by the airport district and has the golf course on it, and the other is owned by Aerostar, which is the parent company of Zodiac. We have contacted both owners about this, and they are in agreement about this change. So there would be no environmental impacts from changing these designations on the map, primarily because we are correcting what we believe is a past oversight. Staff recommends the commission forward a recommendation to the council for approval of a negative declaration and the GPZ. And that concludes staff's presentation, and we're available for any questions.
All right. There really isn't an applicant here. It's staff. Is that accurate?
Yes.
All right. Any questions or comments from the commissioners?
How does this affect the golf course?
The golf course is still able to stay on the site in its current in the current manner. Whether or not they do stay or not is dependent on their lease agreements with the property owner. The zoning isn't going to change that.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? No? And no written communications or public comments? Yeah.
With regard to, Peter, with regard to the change from conservation open space to light industrial, doesn't that change the potential uses of that property?
Because the conservation open space was put there for the purpose of being the channel that would run from Skyway over to the west, that was its only purpose. So because the channel is actually now located in a different spot, it doesn't have a reason to be there anymore. If a project came in on either site, they could use the mixed-use ordinance or try to ask at that point to change the zoning over. And based on our research, we would have the same conclusion that changing it over looks like it's fine.
And so the portion below where it actually exists, where the channel actually exists, what is that zoned?
That's in an airport service district, but the county has an easement that runs over the full expanse of their channel.
Okay.
So they don't need to have a zone or land use.
Okay. That's all the questions I have. Thank you.
Okay. Any further questions? Comments? No? All right. Is there any written communication? I don't think so on this. Okay. Applicant closing statement. Public hearing is closed. Do we have any comments or resolutions by the commissioners?
Do we know what the number of the next?
It is 2659.
There's two of them, right?
In 2660.
There'd be two of them.
I move that by resolution we recommend that the City Council adopt a negative declaration.
Second.
All those in favor?
Well...
Oh, no, I'm sorry.
She gets the talk.
So Commissioner Hernandez?
Aye.
Commissioner Quigley?
Aye.
Commissioner Andrade?
Aye.
Commissioner Brown?
Aye.
Chair Dickerson?
Aye.
Okay, and number two, I move by resolution that we recommend the City Council approve GPZ 2015-0002, 2659.
Second.
Or 2660.
2660.
It's been moved in second.
Okay.
Commissioner Hernandez?
Aye.
Commissioner Quigley?
Aye.
Commissioner Brown?
Aye.
Commissioner Andrade?
Aye.
Chair Dickerson?
Aye. All right. Moving on, item number six, Mission Creek Plaza General Plan Land Use Map Amendment and Zone Change at 2880 Santa Maria Way.
This item is somewhat similar to the prior item. It's a request to change the land use map and zoning map of the city to reflect more of what is on the ground. At one point, the property was developed in a manner that had a permit that specifically allowed a limited number of C2 type uses. It's in a CC zone, so it's only supposed to have convenience commercial type uses, but the applicant at the time wanted to have a little more range. So a permit was approved that said certain number of tenant spaces had to be this type of use, and a certain number had to be another type of use. So a clinic moved in, which is not allowed in the CC. It is allowed in the C2 zone, and it went into one of the spots that was supposed to be a CC use. This is technically a violation of their permit, but staff has no concern that of the clinic at the site, and so it was recommended to the property owner, apply for a GPZ, and let's move this into the C2 zone so we don't have to worry about this type of detail. And the applicant chose to do so, and so the proposal would change the zone from PDCC zone to a PDC2 zone, which matches what's across the street on two sides. It would allow a wider range of commercial uses within the existing building. Staff doesn't see any environmental impacts that could occur because of this, but because this is a GPZ, we did have to do a negative declaration. So staff is recommending that the commission forward a recommendation of approval to council for the negative declaration and the GPZ.
All right. Is the applicant present?
No, I don't believe so.
Yeah, all right. How about questions from the commissioners? No? Any questions? No? All right, any written communications or public comments? No? And nothing from the closing. So public hearing will be closed, and we bring it back to the commission for any discussion.
No, no discussion.
All right. We have a resolution.
You're doing such a good job.
Bang them out.
I move that by resolution, we recommend that the City Council adopt a negative declaration. Do we have a number?
2661.
2661.
Second.
Kathleen?
Commissioner Hernandez?
Aye.
Commissioner Quigley?
Aye.
Commissioner Andrade?
Aye.
Commissioner Brown?
Aye.
Chair Dickerson?
Aye.
And second motion, I move that by resolution, we recommend the City Council approve GPZ 2015-001.
Second.
Resolution 2662.
Resolution 2662.
Commissioner Hernandez?
Aye.
Commissioner Quigley?
Aye.
Commissioner Brown?
Aye.
Commissioner Andrade?
Aye.
Chair Dickerson?
Aye. Motion carries, or resolution carries. Okay, so we'll move on to other business. We still have that pending consent item, I guess. Okay.
The applicant still isn't here yet, so if we could do it after this item.
Item number seven, authorization of a general plan land use map amendment, specific plan amendment, and zone change for Westgate Senior Housing at the northwest corner of Blosser Road and Battles. Staff?
This is a request to change the general plan land use map, amend the specific plan, the Blosser West specific plan, and change the zoning map for about 5.5 acres to convert what is currently all a commercial area. Well, I missed, so let's not do that anymore. On the northwest corner of Battles and Blosser, there's a neighborhood commercial land use. There is a PD permit for that shopping center. The applicant is requesting to change the rear portion of it to make it high-density residential. If you look at the land use map, it is not uncommon to have high-density residential next to the neighborhood commercial. We are in support of the fact that only the part of the site that isn't on Blosser is being asked to change, because the part on Blosser we do think is important to have as a commercial area for all of the new houses that are being built in the area. This is a conceptual site plan of the project. Blosser is now at the bottom of the screen, showing a concept of how there could still be a commercial center on Blosser and the senior housing would be in the back. So the senior housing is the part that has the brown buildings near the top, and the commercial is along Blosser Road. This is just a conceptual plan, so there's still a lot of work that would need to be done on the design. But the overall concept of allowing a portion of this land to change over to high density residential seems to be consistent with the rest of the of specific plan area and the general plan as shown. The applicant is present and has their own presentation. Staff is recommending that the commission make a recommendation to the council to authorize this change. If authorized, then a formal application would come in and more detailed plans will come to the Planning Commission.
Okay. Thank you, Peter. Can we hear from the applicant?
Good evening, Brian Schwartz, Urban Planning Concepts. And we do have just a couple slides to show you this evening. And with that, we could begin. This is the 2008 Westgate Marketplace plan that is currently in place and approved. It's 132,000 square feet of retail commercial. And at the time of its approval, the Tobes Group did a real strong marketing campaign for about 6 years in order to obtain a viable tenant for this space. They had some interest for a little bit. And let me introduce Craig Minus from the Tobes Group also real quick. And
hi, members of the Planning Commission, thank you. I'm running a little late, so Brian started our presentation.
Great,
thank you.
Thanks. Where was I? So back in 2008, they did a very, very strong marketing campaign to fill the tenant spaces. They did have one major anchor that was interested, that was Long's Drugs, but unfortunately CVS bought them out and then the interest faded. After that, the recession also hit. But the marketing for the shopping center continued through multiple different channels and avenues. And at the end, just recently, as of last year, their marketing team suggested that they actually changed the use of the property or look for a different use for the property because there is just simply not enough interest in the property. They did not have one solid offer of tenancy for that center. Next slide, please. This is the slide that Peter just showed, and the revised plan, that commercial center plan that you should see on the bottom, still contains 65,000 square feet of commercial. It contains approximately 25,000 square feet for one anchor, big enough for a grocery store or a major tenant, and a number of small pads for other retail services and restaurants. And then again, the senior housing would be just to the west, and that's adjacent to the heritage site homes that are being currently under construction. This is not a discussion about the PD, but I did want to give you a glimpse into what the plan would kind of look like if it moved forward. It's still in the concept stage, but the idea is to have the two large brown buildings would be three-story buildings with elevator service to them. The three other buildings, next size up, would be two-story walk-ups, and then there would be clubhouse and recreational amenities. The size of the units would be approximately 500, 600 square feet. They're smaller units. This is, I'm not sure if the staff mentioned, it would be for senior housing, and it would be age-restricted and deed-restricted. I think that's all on that slide. You can go to the next one. The Tobes Group, after the recommendation to change the use and go look for a different use, they commissioned a study from the Syracuse Group, for Ernie Syracuse, that looked at senior housing. And what they found is that Santa Maria has a very, very limited amount of senior housing. There is a great demand. The facilities that are in existence have nearly 100% occupancy. And even with that, there is extensive waiting lists of sometimes a year or longer in those facilities. You can also see the proposed site is in red, the red dot there, and you can see that there's really no facilities in that area. And as Westgate builds out, there are a number of different housing types, single family, small lot detached, medium density, the apartments. Sienna just got built, Westgate Apartments, the Lion Apartments, but there is no single family, senior apartments in that area. And so this would really enhance the diversity of that housing type within that area. I also wanted to point out one thing. Peter, if you could go back to the couple slides. Across the street there is the Aquist Apache site. That has approximately 15 acres of commercial zoned for that area. And then also further south along Bedaravia and Blosser is the, I believe it's Bedaravia Plaza, which is going to have approximately 20 acres of commercial. So there's other commercial areas also nearby that will also serve the Westgate Ranch area. That concludes our presentation. We are available for any questions.
Thank you, Brian. Any questions from the commissioners for either the applicant or for staff?
No?
None? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any written communications? I don't see any, or public comment? All right. You want to give a closing statement, or was that good?
I'm sorry.
Do you want to give a closing statement, or were you good with how you left off?
That's fine. We're just available for any questions.
Okay.
Craig, do you have anything else?
No, I mean, I'd say just a couple things. You know, Mike Tobes and the Tobes
Group. For the record, if you can give your name and address.
My name's Craig Minus. I'm director of project management for the Tobes Group.
Okay. And your address? And your address, please?
Minus?
Yeah. Yeah, address?
I'm in 316 or 21 East Victorian, Santa Barbara.
Thank you.
Yeah. I think Brian did a fine job. I would just add that, you know, the Tobes Group has been a big part of Santa Maria, and specifically big part of the Westgate area. You know, we just finished selling out on Lavinia. Sienna Apartments are going very well. And like Brian said, I think, you know, the Westgate senior apartments would add to the diversity of the residential type out there. And we're really looking to serve a community need.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, let's go ahead and close the public hearing, and any discussions or comments by the commission and commissioners?
I'm fine.
I think it's a good, great location for senior housing, so I'm glad to see that.
All right. Do we hear a motion?
Adrian.
Go ahead. You're on a roll.
It's your evening.
I move that the Planning Commission recommend the City Council authorize GPZ 2015-0003.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. Good luck, gentlemen. How does staff want to deal with consent item number three? Since I don't see anybody from, and evidently there's some questions.
I don't know if it is possible to delay the item any further since it's the end of the public, end of the regular meeting.
That's correct.
Since the study session is a separate agenda, we can't wait till after that. So the one message that was clear from the applicant during this process was that they wanted to have an action at this meeting. So I would recommend moving forward and
primarily because the end result. Can you answer a few questions or about the?
Well, let's open the hearing.
Yeah.
Let's go ahead and open the. Let's go ahead and open the hearing then on that particular item.
Verizon Monopine.
Chairman, commissioners, this is a plan development permit application for 2660 Santa Maria Way, and the applicant consultant on behalf of Verizon is proposing a monopine at this location. It would be a 55-foot monopine. They had originally proposed the monopine to be located where that black circle is shown on the screen. The monopine would have an enclosure and would have a backup generator and associated equipment with it. Part of staff's discussions and recommendations to Verizon was to add a line of trees along the northern property line to help further blend the monopine into the surroundings since it is a vacant site. They were agreeable to that, and that was added into the conditions. When the item was noticed and public notice was sent out for it, the property owner to the north did have some concerns with the location of the proposed monopine. And the recommendation and I believe agreement that was struck up between the property owner to the north and the applicant was to move the location of the monopine to where that blue dot is located. The property owner's concern of the office complex to the north was that the location originally proposed was right at the front entrance of that office building, and they did not want a monopine to be the first thing that greeted people. So Verizon agreed to move the monopine to the parking lot, adjacent to the parking lot of the office complex. There was also some additional comments and concerns from the property owner. They wanted to see the enclosure that surrounds the monopine to match the retaining wall that's located along that northern property. They also wanted some screening of landscape and that landscape planter to further mask the monopine. They wanted the grade elevation to be reduced so that the monopine structure itself would be reduced about 2 or 3 feet. All of these things were discussed with Verizon's consultant and agreed upon. Some of them were incorporated into the packet of conditions that you see before you that have the green and yellow and the special conditions. Additional conditions were agreed upon that were supplemented in a white sheet that was handed out. Condition number 6 was revision to the existing special conditions that basically added the language about the enclosure matching the retaining wall. And then condition number 9 was an additional condition that was added, reducing the grade so that the whole structure would be lowered about 2 or 3 feet. All of these details will be worked out during the building permit plan check process that Planning Division would be involved in, and we would make sure that all of these conditions were adhered to and were satisfactory to all parties. That concludes staff's presentation. I'm available for any other questions. I have been working closely with Mr. David Downs, who is the applicant, who is not here right now, and also with Mr. Bert Fugate, who owns the property to the north, the office complex. They are also here, and I believe would like to also speak on behalf of the project. But that concludes staff's presentation. Staff is recommending, with these revised conditions and the additional conditions, approval of the plan development permit.
Thank you very much, Adam. In lieu of the applicant, why don't we have the property, the adjacent property owners and others?
Can we ask questions first?
Sure. We can. Before we bring them on, why don't we have some questions from staff?
I'm not sure I heard you correctly, but you were going to. There was an agreement struck that it. What would be reduced 2 or 3 feet? The 55-foot tall structure itself, or
no, the grade. So the property to the north has an elevation change of about 2 or 3 feet from the western side to the eastern side. So its original proposal, the black circle of where the monopine was going to be located, was about 2 or 3 feet lower than the property to the north. So basically a great portion of the monopine was masked by the retaining wall and the higher elevation. As you move to the east, the elevation rises, and so then the monopine would be at grade with the office complex. So the property owner to the north was requesting that the grade be evened out, and so that the whole enclosure and monopine itself would be leveled to what it was towards the west. So that would drop the monopine enclosure about 2 or 3 feet. It's basically stating that they want the elevation of that monopine to be the same as that concrete pad that's on the property. That Verizon was agreeable to doing that.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions of staff? Peter, did you have something you want to interject with?
I just have handouts that the applicant is going to go. I'm sorry, the representative of the neighboring property owner is going to go.
Representative of the neighboring. Well, let's move right on into that then. Written communications and public comments. Ms. Tamora.
Good evening. My name is Lori Tamora, and I'm here with Mr. Bert Fugate in regards to the adjacent property owner and the concerns that were raised. Mr. Fugate received the notice last week on this project, looked at the record, and realized that the monopine would be immediately 50 feet from the door of his office building, Charter Brokerage. Concerns were raised as regards to how that would look, what the transition would be between his property and the one adjacent to it. So as you go through these slides, you can see the parking lot that is, again, the door to his facility, and then immediately beyond that would be the monopine building. One of the other pictures that are in this group of photographs is the trash enclosure, which you can see is very well decorated, stucco siding, barn-like doors, even an arbor over the top of it. So it's a nice-looking structure as part of the overall architecture of the building. And the second to the last photograph illustrates how the grade changes to the property line to the south. And it at one point you can see there's a retaining wall, and then it just kind of daylights to the surface of the adjacent parking lot. So over the course of Monday and Tuesday, several emails and discussions went back and forth with Netta and Peter, as well as the representative for Verizon. And the agreement was to move the structure to the east, lower the site a little bit so that it would respect the topography that was towards the west. And the more important thing was the agreement to do some decorative wall. The wording on the revised conditions that were provided to the Planning Commission, we would like to recommend one change. And the reason why we showed these photographs and the illustration of the trash enclosure is that's what we'd like to see as far as the architectural details of the wall that's surrounding the monopine. Have it stuccoed, a cap, something that makes it look like it's just an extension of the development and doesn't stand out. The retaining wall that's in, and the wording here on condition 6 says shall match the material and color of the retaining wall. What we'd like to see is have that change to match the material and color of the buildings in the El Potrero project. That, I think, would address the concern that we have as far as the transition of the project at El Potrero to this monopine and the structure. We appreciate the additional landscaping that will feather out from the monopine, so it looks like it's tied to something rather than just one pine tree in the middle of a field. And other than that, I think we're very appreciative of the cooperation with staff and with the representatives for Verizon, acknowledging the concerns that we had, and we're ready to move forward with the project based on these changes. And we're available for any questions, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Morrow.
I have a question.
One question from...
You were referring to changes in the green sheets, or which, where were you referring?
It was the two paragraphs that were provided as amendments to the conditions. I'm not sure. Netta prepared these probably at 5 o'clock today.
So this is...
It would be a revision to condition number 6. So instead of saying retaining wall located on the adjoining property to the north, it would say buildings in the El Potrero office complex to the north. And we're agreeable to that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank
Any
you very much.
Any other questions? No? Thank you. I don't think there's any other public comment or communications, so what's that, gentlemen? Certainly. Please give your name and address.
Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Dale Adams. I have the property on the corner, right on the tip. And I just have a question. I was actually contacted quite a while ago about a cell site in my little property on the corner. I declined it, but I'm kind of curious with the size of property that I'm showing there, is there another plan going on with that property? I'm not really up to speed on all this. I just got here tonight and got the news on this, but is there other development going to happen on that parcel more than just have that monopine put in there?
Stop. Not that we're currently aware of.
Okay. And it's still, what's the zoning on that property? Are they changing that to put that site on there?
No, they're not. It's zone okay. PDC2 and will remain that.
Okay. Okay.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sir, if you could do us a favor, and could you fill out one of the blue slips and pass it forward, just so we have it for the record? I'd appreciate it. Okay. Any further questions or comments from the public? No. I didn't quite make it. I hope he is safe. I hope he hasn't. Something terrible has not happened to him. So we'll just move on to the public hearing being closed, bring it back to the commission. And are there any comments or questions by commissioners? I have one comment or question. and I don't know that's going to make much of a difference, but in all the pictures, the height of it looks disproportionately huge compared to even the rendition of what the trees might look like. I almost feel like it's the one lone redwood from Yosemite that happened to migrate here. Is that a standard height? Or, because I know that, for instance, when we were dealing with the car wash, that we asked that to be lowered some. I mean, how do the heights compare on the two? I don't recall the height of the other one.
This is proposed at 55 feet. That is pretty standard. We have other monopines in the city that are taller. Some at the parks are at 65 and even 70 feet. As part of the conditions for the addition of trees, we did condition that other pine trees also be added around it as to help blend in and eventually grow to the same height as this monopine with a variety of other trees. So the trees that this photo simulation shows aren't at full maturity. Granted, it'll take a while for them to get to full maturity, but when they do, it should be about proportional to what the other trees look like.
Okay. All right.
And then if I could also add, when this application first came in, our first response to the applicant was, is there not another location? Is there an area that has some tall buildings nearby that maybe you could locate on? And they were able to show us that they had gone to every taller building in that immediate area and were not able to get approval. There aren't that many tall buildings, but there are a couple. Because the idea of putting a monopine on a vacant site was not our first choice. But they were willing to work with us and do a lot of planting, move it away from the street. So we felt that is the best that we can make out of the situation.
In a situation like that, when you're doing a lot of planting, is it assumed that the trees that you're planting there are able to, on their own, take root deep enough to get watered properly, or do they put in an irrigation system, or what do they do to make sure that the real trees that they're planting?
These will be irrigated.
Okay.
Along with the shrubs around the enclosure.
Okay. Okay, I don't have any further questions. Anyone else?
I have a comment. I used to have an office in that Los Potreros, and there is a need for a cell tower. I do know that, because I would get a lot of dropped calls. So. Just want to make sure that.
Okay. So do we handle it as a motion? Okay. All right. Do I hear a motion from the commission?
I move that the Planning Commission approve Plan Development Permit PD 2014-0016 with the revised additional special conditions number 6 and number 9.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. Good luck to the applicant wherever he is. Okay. Do we have a report on the City Council actions?
Yes, we do.
Last night there was a proclamation, or several proclamations by Council, but one was about National Bike Month. It's important to remember that we do have a bikeway master plan. There is going to be a community meeting scheduled for May 12th at Shepherd Hall at 6:30 to get community input on which segments of our master plan we should build first or prioritize. So that has been, notification of that meeting has been spread out to all the local bicycle groups and such. So if any of the commissioners are interested in attending, you are more than welcome.
That it?
That's all.
All right. 9, oral reports from Planning Commission and staff. Do we have any oral reports from the Planning Commission and staff?
I have an update on the downtown Entrada and zoning ordinance process. So after the last meeting where the commission talked about the importance of getting more outreach and feedback on these plans, we have changed the whole schedule around. We're going to take just the downtown plan to council on June 2nd, just to get some buy-in on the fundamentals. We are then going to let the council know that we plan on having the document available for the public for at least a 30-day period. We'll do a press release, have the document online, and probably schedule a community meeting as well. In addition, we have already, and we will keep on meeting with stakeholders as they request it. The expectations are the comments we're going to get back are going to fall into a handful of categories. Some will be things that align very much with what the commission and council talked about in October of last year. And those could result into changes that we can easily make to the plan. Some comments will go beyond the scope of what the direction was to do to the plan at this time. We will still have those and summarize those and provide that to the planning commission and council. But there are going to be some changes that the public might ask for that if it goes beyond what the council and commission directed us to do in October, we aren't going to go down those paths at this time. So the likely, in our mind, the likely time that the plan will come back to the commission for a study session will be in the summertime, probably in the latter half. And the hope is that the adoption by council could be in the fall. Now, in Trotta, we're going to put on hold until our downtown plan is complete. And then the zoning ordinance amendments, we're going to break into pieces as was recommended by the commission. We're going to bring the sign ordinance piece sooner, and we're having outreach with the local sign companies about that. I believe it's this week. And then other parts of the zoning ordinance amendments will bring in logical chunks instead of one large amendment. So wanted to let the commission know what the plan of attack is going to be, and if you have any questions or comments, I can try to answer them.
Any questions or comments?
Does that mean that our study sessions are going to change from a different time than what they are, what they have been in the past?
We're going to be talking about that on this.
Yeah, we'll be talking about that later tonight.
That's coming up.
All right.
That's going to be on our study
session. On our study session. We're still in
the... I thought we were into that one.
Study session.
Any further questions about this particular item? I have one question. I just want to see if I understand. So you're going to take it to the city council first to see if generally they like it, and then take it to the public and do outreach, or did I misunderstand that?
Yeah, I mean, that was the plan. And the reason we're doing this is because when this whole thing started, you know, the direction was very specific to do certain things, clean up certain things, and have it done very quickly. So we want to make sure that the things we did look at are at least in the ballpark of what the council is comfortable with before we go in and do major public outreach.
Okay. Any further questions? No? All right. Thank you very much. And with that, I adjourn this regular meeting of the Planning Commission. And let's take a 5-minute break, let's say till 7:25, and we will then...